Okay, we're ready to start. First, I'd like you, if you can, talk about the old days. You played with King Oliver for a year, didn't you?
Yes, about a year.
That was after Louis Armstrong moved away from the band, wasn't it?
Oh, many moons after, you know, because that was an older tribe than me, you know.
Right.
I came like in the middle of that.
But then you played with, let's see, from there, where did you go?
From King Oliver? Then I played with a band called the Bostonians. They were out of Salina, Kansas. And it was a nice little group, about 8 or 10 pieces.
Anybody that we might know in the band?
Oh, I'm sure you wouldn't. The boss man's name was Art Bronson, so I know you never heard of him. He played piano.
Did you make your first records with Basie?
Yes, my first records, I made them in Chicago.
Was it the old Basie band?
Right, during the time we was playing at the Grand Terrace.
Did you always play the way you did, or did your... I mean, Coleman Hawkins was the tenor sax man then, in those days.
Yeah, well, I had a lot of trouble along those days, because the people couldn't understand the way I sound, and they wanted me to play like Coleman Hawkins, you know? Well, teach his own, you know? Things like that, so I played in a band, and it was about 3 boys from the West. They fired the trombone player, great big envelope. Then they fired the trumpet player. He was going, well, I'm the 3rd party. I know they're going to fire me too, you dig? We were all from Kansas City, you know? We came to New York, so we wasn't in the New York clique, you know? So that made a difference. So I went to him and asked him, could I get a recommendation so I could split and go back home, you know? So he did, and I went back, and then I started playing with Andy Kirk.
But you replaced Hawkins, didn't you, in the Fletch Anderson?
Yes, I did.
Wasn't it pretty tough for you to replace him when everybody was so used to the Hawkins style?
Oh, yeah, I caught all kind of trouble, you know, like that, because most of the people would come out to hear him and see me up there and listen to the way I sound, you know, and they're looking for him. I think he was in Switzerland or Sweden or something like that.
But when did you first meet Billie Holiday?
When I came to New York in 1934. I used to live at a house with her mother, you know, because I didn't know my way around. And she taught me a lot of things, you know, and got me little record dates, you know, play behind her, little solos and things like that.
Well, you're her favorite soloist.
Well, she is mine, too, so that's a draw.
I understand she gave you the name, Prez, didn't she?
Yeah, she did. And I gave her the name of Lady Day. So right. That was even.
But I think she has said that she sort of, her style of singing is formed after your style on the tenor sax.
Well, I think you can hear that on some of the old records, you know. Sometimes I'd sit down and listen to myself and it sound like 2 of the same voices, if you don't be careful, you know, of the same mind or something like that.
Tell me, did you ever make records with Hawkins?
With Hawkins? No, I never did.
Never did?
Mm-mm.
You probably will someday. Now, is there anything you can tell us about Billie Holiday, or any funny incidents when you were on the road with the Basie band or something like that? It might be of interest.
Oh, no, I couldn't think of nothing like that. I just know we were all happy, you know, always waiting to go to work and things like that.
I was talking to Basie the other day on this same show.
I'm listening.
And he was telling me that he preferred recording in the old days, when you had just one microphone, and now he said you have the rhythm section around the corner, and it's so confusing, and the feeling isn't there. Do you feel that way?
One microphone?
Yes, in the old days when they had just one microphone. Now it's become so technical, you know, there are microphones all over the studio, and you're sort of split up. You're not together, I mean, in a big band.
Well, I don't think I'd go for that, because, I mean, it's... if you only have one mic, you got to run over to the mic and play and then come and sit down. It's only one mic. Well, they make it convenient. Here's a mic here and a mic there and a mic everywhere, you know?
But didn't you have just one mic when you recorded with Spacey?
Yeah. That's true.
And, several musicians that I've interviewed have said the same thing, that they felt that the spirit was more there in the old days when you were recording. There were clinkers, but there was more feeling in the music because it wasn't so technical. And nowadays, everything is very technical. There's high fidelity and everything. And they feel that they just can't get into the right feeling.
No, I still don't buy that.
You don't? Well, that's good.
To each his own. No, I don't think like that.
What other bands have you played with?
Bands?
Mostly recording groups, I take it.
Well, like Teddy Wilson Records and things like that. I never played with him regularly.
Do you have any favorite records of your own?
No, I really couldn't say this offhand. I just, you know, when I get by myself, I just play them and enjoy them all, you know.
What about, did you ever hear Bessie Smith? I'm sure you did.
Yeah. I thought she was a wild lady with her blues. Mm-hmm.
Do you think there's anybody nowadays who can sing like her?
Yeah.
Whom, of the vocalists today, whom do you like?
Oh, you left to Bessie Smith, huh? You didn't want me to say that.
Well, no, I mean, you liked Bessie Smith, didn't you?
Yeah, well, sometime you pick up on K-Star and listen to her voice and play one of Bessie Smith's records. See if you hear anything.
You feel there is a similarity there?
Yeah, very much.
Well, we have played K-Star records on the show,
mm-hmm.
and she definitely does have a good voice for jazz. How about some of the new singers that are popping out, like Dakota State and all these singers that are coming out nowadays?
No, I can tell you just really, my favorite singer is K-Star. No, that's the wrong name. What's that other lady's name? Her husband has a band.
It's not Joe Stafford.
There you are. Yeah, I'll go there.
Joe Stafford is your favorite singer?
Yeah. And Lady Day, and I'm through.
But Joe Stafford doesn't sing jazz, does she?
No, but I hear her voice and the sounds and the way she puts her songs on.
You like that? Well, that's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
What about, how do you feel now when you hear your old records? Do you feel that you...
I think it was nice during those days, you know. See, like I have a lot of trouble on the bandstand. They'll come up and ask me, how come you don't play like you played when you played with Count Basie? Well, that's not progressive, you know. If I'm going to stay there and play that same stuff year after year, well, Jesus, I'll be an old man, you know. So I don't think like that, so I have to try to think of little new tricks and little new sounds and things like that. That's the way I live.
Are there any tenor sax men nowadays, newcomers, that you like particularly?
Well, I imagine I'll just say I like them all. They all sound the same to me. Because most of them all went to Juilliard, you dig? And whoever that teacher was, he taught them all the same thing. This one will stop playing it. This one will pick it up and play the same thing, you know? In my mind, where's the individual that's going to come out and play for himself? Like if you have 13 people, and a teacher teach all 13 of them, you mean to tell me out of 13 he can't get one individual? So that's the way I think.
Well, so you don't have any favorites?
Oh, no, I like them all.
You like them all?
Oh, I like modern.
So you just feel they should be more individual,
mm-hmm.
and more individual styles.
That's so.
Well, how do you feel about Coleman Hawkins' style?
Well, the way I look at him, he's the first person that played the tenor saxophone, you know, who woke you up and let you know there was a tenor saxophone and things like that. And so naturally all the kiddies, you know, was copying his style and things like that. That's about all I can say on that.
I take it you don't think very highly of his style. It's not your type of music.
Well, that's incomplete.
Now, when you travel with the Jazz at the Philharmonic, you've done a lot of traveling with them
right. All
over Europe. How do you feel the Europeans, how do they react? Do you feel any difference
No.
in the audience in Europe?
No, I register very nice over there. I've been over twice.
Like Dizzy Gillespie, he feels that they appreciate the music more than the American audiences. How do you feel about that?
No, I don't think I'll buy that.
You think it's about the same?
It's just left that if a person like you, they like you, and if they don't like you, that's all.
Do you ever play the clarinet anymore?
Yeah, I just made some records for Norman Granz about 4, 5, or 6 months ago on my clarinet.
So I heard some records with, was it Walter Page and his Blue Devils that you made?
Yeah, many moons ago.
Way Down Yonder in New Orleans.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Are these the latest records you made? Haven't you made any since? The ones with Norman Granz, I mean?
Well, the way we make records for Norman, him and I, pardon me, you make so many records, and then he keep them and put them like in a vault, and he stash them, and when he wants to go and get them, you know, then he bring them out. So you can never tell when you may hear one, because that's his business, you know?
I see.
So that's the way it is.
What do you feel about the reissues of the old Basie records? Do you ever go back and listen to the old records by
mm-hmm.
Basie?
I have some in my room. I listen at them, you know, and try to dig little mistakes, little things that you could have, you know, did a little better or something like that.
We did a show on Coleman Hawkins the other day, about 2 weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
and we played one of your, we explained the difference between your style, and we played one of your records, Lester Leaps In, with Count Basie's Kansas City 7.
Mm-hmm.
That was a long time ago.
Right.
Do you still play that number?
I must have made about 3 or 4 different, you know, records of that. Yeah, that's just like a crip, you know. I have to play it all night long.
Just like, Hawkins, they're always asking him to play Body and Soul.
Same difference. Mm-hmm.
So what are you doing now? Are you just touring the States and playing various spots?
No, I've been off. I was a little sick, you know, and had to go to the hospital and all that. I haven't worked since the 5th of August, July. This is my first week that I've had, you know. And it takes you a little time to build your chops up, you know.
Yeah.
See?
Before we close, I just want to ask you, what do you think of Mahalia Jackson, her voice?
I think that's great.
She has been compared with Bessie Smith. Do you think she could sing like Bessie Smith if she sang the blues?
A little deep for me there, you know, because she's religious, right?
Yes, very religious.
Mm-hmm.
She won't sing anything but religious songs, but she has this tremendous voice and very strong voice and powerful.
Yeah, I heard that record. What did she play? Hold My Hand or something like that?
Yeah, she's got so many of them, I can't remember them all.
Yeah.
He's got the whole world in his hand.
Yeah, something like that.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you very much, and now we'll take the tape and we'll edit it and we'll use it.
All right. It's a pleasure meeting you, Chris.
Pleasure meeting you. Thank you.